Good morning. In this session, we will talk about the various means of transport and communication. In the last classes across the human geography, we have understood how over the years population has evolved, what were the characteristics of population, what are the types of economic activities that were seen, of which we discussed the primary and the secondary activities so far. And in this session, we would be focusing on the tertiary activities where we would be specifically talking about transportation and communication. Now, if I take a very big picture, I can say transport could be explained as air transport, water transport, land transport, and one more form of transport, which is a pipeline transport. Now, when I say the word pipeline, the most obvious thing that comes to your mind is oil, natural gas. But there is also pipelines. There are also pipelines which supply milk from factories. So definitely each of these modes of transport are very, very crucial. Why do we understand these modes of transport? The idea is to carry a thing from one place to another. It's a kind of facility that is being provided to carry either goods or services or passengers. So with that idea, you have the movement that generates. Now, this all started with the history and when we talked about Industrial Revolution. So what happened during Industrial Revolution was there was so lot of production. Now, once there is so much production, it needs to be supplied somewhere. Otherwise, there would be bulks and bulks that would be started to that would basically accumulate within the warehouses. In order to solve this problem, there was an urgent need to work on the transportation means so that whatever is produced in the company is transported across the globe. And with this transportation, you have another important aspect that started, and what was that? That was obviously trade. So all of those phenomena, we could say, are interlinked, and therefore we say any economic process, one sector is dependent on another sector, and a prosperity in one sector would lead to development in another sector. Again, when we talk about these transportation processes, we need to understand whether we are having a kind of organized service or an unorganized service. Is it a kind of daily transport that is witnessed, or it's once in a while, let's say, a kind of recreational transport that is witnessed? So whether it is organized or unorganized is also important to understand. So this was a kind of quick framework to understand transport, the modes of transport, of which we would discuss each of those separately as we proceed. Now, let's say I have different commodities with me. One of the commodity that I have, let's say fruits, of which you have fruits which are highly perishable and they are high value commodity. What would happen? The only best way I could transport is through air, because since they are perishable, since they have high value, I need to save the time in order to save the shelf life of the fruit that I am transporting. So we need to understand what mode of transport we need to use as we evolve. Now, land transportation, over the years, we have seen that it started with the time of kings, where you had palki, or what was known as palanquin, where four people used to carry the bride. It was commonly seen in India. In other parts of the country, you had the beast of the burdens across the world, obviously in India as well. So donkey is considered as one of the beast of burden. Now, animals were used, but since all these modes of transport, whether it was by human effort, whether it was by animal effort, were definitely slow. With the advent of industrialization, you had steam engines that came in. Back in 18th century, you had the development of steam engines. In India, we say railway line developed with the advent of Britishers in India, where there was a need to move from one place to another, and the clearing of the forest took place, where you had the wood that was taken into consideration for developing of the sleeper coaches. So first public railway line was built in India. But before India, it was back in 1825 where this railway line started in the world, and that was between Stockton and Darlington in North England. So when there was We say the development of a steam engine. Definitely with the engine you would have a track that would be there, and with the track you would have the railway line that would come. So this railway line from Stockton to Darlington, the idea was to transport the commercial grains, the farming that has been done, the mining that was being done, and the manufacturing to America. So basically it opened the frontiers for trade, not only in the regions of Britain, but ultimately transporting it to the other parts of the world, where America was one of the major buyers or the potential buyers, we could say. Slowly, after the steam engine, you had the internal combustion engine that came into line. You had later on the cableways, ropeways, pipelines that evolved. So liquid material went through the pipelines. You had cable cars that operated. Huge freight containers were there. So these were either through the land mode or through the ocean vessels. You had motor trucks that were released. And finally, in the areas which were highly hilly, the terrain was not good, you had ropeways that started, mainly in the areas where roads were not built or the regions were not accessible for the roads to come into existence. As we said, pack animal or beast of burden were commonly seen. So in Western countries, you had horses. In North America, there were reindeers. In North Europe, Siberia, the tundra areas, the taiga areas, you had mainly the reindeers that were seen. Mules were preferred in the mountainous areas. Similarly, in India, you saw donkeys. In the regions of Arab, you had camels that were seen. And also, for pulling the carts, we used bullock carts. So, bullocks were used. Now, if we talk about roads, we have the metalled roads and the unmetalled roads. So, roads I can classify as metalled. Now, usually the urban area has a metalled road. However, the roads could be unmetalled, as in the case of a rural area. In the developed countries, you have better quality of roads that was seen. And as a result, what happened with the metalled road was, during the rainfall, the precipitation or the rainfall could not seep. However, this could seep in the rural areas because the roads were unmetalled. As a result, you had problem of urban floods coming in the rural, in the urban areas or the metropolitan areas. Now, if you look onto the world scenario, we have nearly 15 million kilometers of motorable roads that are seen, of which North America accounts for highest, and that is nearly 33% of the total roads across India, across the world. If we talk about the highest density of the road and the highest number of the vehicles on the road, it is Europe, mainly the Western Europe. The next thing that came with development of road was more number of automobiles coming in. So with more automobiles, definitely there was problem of traffic congestion. So traffic congestion, mainly during peak hours, you had higher load, and during the off-peak hours, you had a trough that was seen. So if we consider this as a wave, you had the crust and the trough that was seen. So that's again important to understand how the things worked. So you had idea of carpool that started, where we tried to reduce the stress on the roads. Similarly, you had metros that came in, you had the city bus services that started in. In India, we had a unique project which is known as Bharatmala project. Now, this Bharatmala project subsumed two important projects. One was the North-South corridor, East-West corridor, and another was the Golden Quadrilateral, which connected the four metropolitans of India. So all these projects were subsumed under Bharatmala. Bharatmala project, working with Bizag Gandhinagar, talked about the traffic points and creation of either flyovers or underbridges to make all the national highways free of any traffic signal. So that's the kind of idea that was propounded. It was not only in India, but across the world. If we say in Canada, you had the Trans-Canadian Highway that was seen from Vancouver in British Columbia to St. John's in Newfoundland. And then you had the Alaska Highway that was seen in the region of Alaska. You had Transcontinental Straits Highway that was seen. And this was in Australia from Darwin in the north coast to Melbourne via Alice Springs. So that was the route of Transcontinental Straits Highway. Then you also have highways in Russia, mainly from Moscow to Vladivostok. So that was one of the longest highways in Russia that was seen. Similarly, in Africa, you had numerous highways that were seen, mainly from the regions of Algiers to Guiana. And India, we have already talked about. So that was a kind of road network. When it comes to railway, initially we talked about steam engine. We moved to coal engines. Later on, we moved to diesel and finally to electric engines. So electric trains started, and now we are talking about bullet trains, Shatabdi trains, Train 18, which is a trainless engine. So those are the kinds of developments that have witnessed, that we have witnessed in India. But it's not just in India. Across the world, you have numerous development in the railway networks. You have metro rails for local commuting population. Europe has the highest density of the railway network across the world. There is about 440,000 kilometers of railway that have been built up, which is either double or multi-track. Belgium has highest density of railway as of now, with every 1 kilometer of railway in 6.5 kilometer square area. Some of the industrial areas have much higher density of railway lines in order to transport the material. You have Channel Tunnel, which was operated by Eurotunnel Group, which connects London with Paris across the English Channel, and that was, has been a unique development. In Russia also, you have railways that have developed enormously. A very dense network is seen mainly in the western parts of Russia, in the regions of Urals. South America, two major hubs, you have Pampas in Argentina, and then you have Coffee Fazendas in Brazil. Both of those have very high density of railway lines that are seen. You also have short tracks that are seen in Peru, Chile, Ecuador, and so on. West Asia, where the population is sparse, we also see the development of railway network. But besides that, you have numerous development of railway lines along the mining areas, mainly in the regions of Africa, where you have the Zambia copper belt, you have the Katanga region, the Katanga mining area. You have a dense network of the railway line that is seen. Now, some of the railway lines are very, very important. So what are transcontinental railway lines that run across in the continent? So the first and the foremost is the Trans-Siberian, very, very important. It runs in Russia from St. Petersburg in the west to Vladivostok on the Pacific coast, and this is passing through numerous towns like Moscow. You have Chita, Kharkov. So those are some of the important towns that have been covered on the Trans-Siberian line. It is the most important route in Asia and is one of the longest double track route in the world that is seen. The next is Trans-Canadian, that transverses the region of Canada, runs from Halifax in the east to Vancouver in the way, in the west on the Pacific coast, and this is again across the Canada. You have the railway line that is seen. In the regions of North America, you have mainly the wheat belts of prairies and the coniferous parts in the north, where you have the railway track that is extensively seen. In Australia, you have the Transcontinental Australian Highway that is seen, which runs west to east and also connects some of the southern countries, southern parts or the southern towns. You also have Orient Express. Now, this is from Paris to Istanbul, a very important line crossing most of the European countries, and the journey now is reduced to only 96 hours in contrast to the previous 10 days that was there. So from 10 days we have reduced it merely to 96 hours, and that's very, very important to understand. The next is water transport. In India we have a good example of Sagarmala Pariyojana. We have a separate class on it. You can just check out the links. The next is the cost. The water is considered as one of the cheapest means of transportation. It is divided into either oceanic routes or inland routes. Now, ocean routes offer a higher transportation across countries, so the maintenance cost is comparatively lower. Inland transport is usually within the region. So in India, we are talking about national waterways. We are talking to enhance development through national waterways, but still we do not have a lot of inland water transport. But yes, in a region of North America, the Great Lakes, you have the homes Huron, Ontario, Michigan, Erie, and Superior. These five Great Lakes, you have most of the transportation that occurs as an inland transportation. Now, some of the major ocean routes, if we talk about, so North Atlantic Sea Route, which is also called as the Big Trunk Route, is one of the important routes, connects Northeast America to Northwest Europe. And these two are the major industrially developed hubs of the world, and therefore most of the trade occurs here. 1/4 of the total world's foreign trade is accounted only in this region. So North Atlantic region between Northeast America and Northwest Europe is very, very important. Similarly, you have the Mediterranean Indian Ocean route. Now here you have the development of Suez Canal that is seen. Through this, you have a lot of natural resources that has been traded. Now south of Africa, you have the Cape of Good Hope. So from the Atlantic Ocean, you connect the Western Europe and West Africa. From the South American region, so you have the Cape Horn in Africa, that is one of the major centers, the Cape Town. And then you also have the various sea routes in the south. So you have South Pacific Sea Route, you have South Atlantic Sea Route. But definitely, since the major industrialized countries are located towards the northern hemisphere, you have major the most chunk of trade that is occurring in the northern areas. Next to it, you have coastal shipping. Now, coastal shipping occurs across the coastline. So let's say in India, you have the western coast and the eastern coast. Supplying from western coast to eastern coast could be done through coastal shipping as one of the ways. Again, you have numerous shipping canals that have come up. So Suez Canal and Panama Canal are two classic examples. Now, for Suez Canal, every ship that crosses takes 10 to 12 hours to cross it. The tolls are heavy. Sometimes it's cheaper to go over the longer route of the Cape route. However, you do have the shorter route, which is the Suez Canal that is seen. The next is Panama Canal. Now, when we say Panama Canal, the most important thing is it is connecting the Atlantic Ocean with the Pacific Ocean, and this is constructed through the Panama Isthmus. You have numerous locks in between. Now, locks are unique features where you have the water level which basically changes. So you have the ship which is placed at a higher level, and then the lock moves down, so the ship moves on to the lower level, goes at a lower level, moves up, goes at an upper level. So that's how a phenomena of locks work. You have this route that has reduced, the Panama route that has reduced the distance between New York and San Francisco by nearly 13,000 kilometers. So definitely a remarkable development with the canals that have been developed, mainly the Suez Canal and the Panama Canal. Inland waterway, as we said, navigability is important. So continuous flow of water must be there. Transportation technology should be good. So some of the best known inland waterways, we could say, are Rhine Valley, Rhine waterways in Germany. You have Danube waterways and Volga waterways. So most of those are European regions. Now, Rhine is a waterway between Germany and Netherlands. It is navigable for nearly 700 kilometers. Most of the coal fields are being transported through this waterway system. Danube is again important. It arises in the region of Black Forest in Europe and flows eastward. Most of the items that are exported through Danube waterway are wheat, maize, timber, and machines. So you have the Volga, which is mainly in the region of Caspian Sea. Then Volga to Moscow is another important canal that is being connected. In North America, we already talked about Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence, which connects the Great Way finally into the Atlantic Ocean. And then you have the Mississippi Missouri. So Mississippi waterway is again important. So you have the Mississippi Ohio waterway that connects the interior part of America with the Gulf of Mexico. Now, air transport, definitely it is expensive, but it is one of the fastest means, very suitable for long distance travel. The connectivity revolution has led to numerous developments under air transportation. The accessibility has improved. There have been intercontinental air routes that have been established. So most of the southern parts of the world lack air services, and that's due to the limited population that is there, the limited landmass, and limited economic development that is seen. Pipelines, as we said, liquids and gases are the best to be transported through pipelines. So oil and gas pipelines are most commonly heard. But in New Zealand, we have milk being transferred from pipelines from the farms to the factories. So that's another development that we have witnessed. Big Inch is one of the most famous pipelines that carries petrol from the oil well to the Gulf of Mexico in Northeast state, from Gulf of Mexico to the Northeast America. And that's the Big Inch pipeline, very, very important. We have a proposed pipeline from Iran to India via Pakistan for the oil and natural gas that is under discussion. Now, the next is communications. So far we talked about the transportation. Coming on to communication. Now, definitely, once you have a transportation, the communication probabilities would increase. Now, early 20th century, mid-20th century, you had telegraph and telephone companies that enjoyed monopoly in America, and that was AT&T, American Telephone and Telegraph Services in America. Over the years, we shifted from DSL, copper loops to optic fibers. So these allowed huge quantity of data to be transmitted at a faster pace, virtually error-free. So there was a kind of revolution in communication. Internet grew. You had satellite networks that came in. So satellite communication started. And so far, we say nearly 1,000 million people across 100 countries have access to the communication networks, to the satellite networks. From India, Aryabhat was one of the major satellites which was launched, the first satellite that was launched in 1979. And since then, we had Bhaskar, Rohini, InSat, and numerous other satellites that are part of it. So GSAT, one of the recent. Now, internet, as we said, India is one of the major consumers of internet. World Wide Web, as we refer to it. So you have the URL and the domain that's there. Now, URL is the uniform resource locator, the unique ID of the location of your page on a web or a internet. The speed of the internet over the years have evolved. So previously, it was just 256 kilobytes per second. It evolved to 512, and now we say most of the networks provide at least 1 Mbps. So you have a systematic development in internet. With the development in internet came in digital economy. So you have digital payments that flourish. You have telemedicine, tele-education systems that started. E-commerce that started, e-commerce in the form of business to business, business to customer, and customer to business. So those were the kind of various developments that were seen with the internet that came in. Okay, so with this, we cover our lecture for today. We'll be covering the remaining topics of NCERT geography in the upcoming sessions. So stay tuned for further updates. And definitely, if you have any doubts, any comments, leave those in the comment section below. I'll be more than happy to solve those. Stay subscribed for upcoming videos. Have a wonderful day.